California, 1943.
And don't ever give up doing something for the boys. What if that sweater you started did turn out to be a muffler with short sleeves? What if that chocolate cake did turn out to be no good? There's something every man, woman, and child in this great land of ours can do, and that is to buy more war bonds than we're buying now.
Hey, step aside, buddy.
What are you doing there?
They built the sidewalks on Olive Street out of rubber blocks, black and white. Look at that pattern. What are we doing? We're ripping them up to give them to the government. There's a war on, buddy. Hadn't you heard?
I've heard. This where the Giller Lane Company is?
You like perfume?
Wear it all the time. Giller Lane Regal, the champagne of perfumes. One drop of that in the hollow of your throat and the matched pink pearls start falling on you like summer rain. We should try it.
Yeah, another wise guy. I don't need that kind of excuse to stay out of the army.
Neither do I, buddy.
Yes, this is the Giller Lane Company. Can I help you?
I'm Philip Marlowe. Miss Adrienne Fromsett. I'd like to see Mr. DeRace Kingsley.
Have you an appointment?
No appointment, Miss Fromsett.
It is very difficult to see Mr. Kingsley without an appointment. What is the nature of your business, Mr. Marlowe?
You mind telling him I'm from Lieutenant McGee?
Mr. Kingsley is in conference.
Miss Fromsett, I'm on my way to lunch. Any calls?
Mr. Marlowe is here to see you from Lieutenant McGee.
Never heard of either of them.
Are you Mr. Kingsley?
Who the hell did you think I was? Who's McGee?
They call him Violets on account of he chews little throat pastilles that smell of violets. He's a big man with soft silvery hair, and when last seen he was wearing a neat blue suit, a Homburg hat, and smoking opium in a short briar pipe.
I don't like your manner.
That's all right, I'm not selling it.
I'll give you exactly 3 minutes, God knows why. Come in. Show me your license, Marlowe.
Well, there it is.
I asked Sheriff Peterson to recommend a reliable private detective. Now, who's this McGee?
He's in the Hollywood substation of the sheriff's office. You can check with him.
I guess you'll do, but don't get flip with me. When I hire a man, he's my man. He does exactly what I tell him or he goes out fast. Is that clear? Now, what do you charge?
25 a day in expenses. 8 cents a mile for my car.
Too much. 15 a day flat. I hope I'm not too tough for you.
Just what is it you want done, Mr. Kingsley?
Why should you care? You do all kinds of work, don't you?
Only the fairly honest kinds, and I get $100 down as a retainer from strangers. And as for being too tough, most of my clients start out either by weeping down my shirt or bawling me out to show who's boss. Usually, they end up very reasonable, if they're still alive.
Do you lose many?
Not if they treat me right.
You'll do, Marlowe. 25 a day it is. Now, I want you to find my wife.
Okay, I'll find your wife.
She's been gone a month. In May, she went up to a cabin we have in the mountains near Puma Point. It's a private lake, 3 miles from the village. I own it with 2 other men. We all built cabins there, a little fawn lake. The only people up there all the time are Bill Chess and his wife. He's a disabled war veteran. He looks after the place in return for living rent-free. Crystal was due to come back down to L.A. on the 12th of June for a party, and she never showed up.
What have you done about it?
Nothing.
Why not?
Read this telegram.
El Paso, June 14. Am crossing to get Mexican divorce. Stop. Will marry Chris. Stop. Good luck and goodbye, Crystal. Who is Chris?
Chris Lavery. She can have him, and he can have her, and to hell with both of them.
And why am I here?
Crystal and I have been washed up for years. We live our own lives. She has $20,000 a year from her family's oil business. She plays around. This Lavery is a professional chaser. I was just surprised that she'd actually marry him. Beyond that, I didn't care. And until the day before yesterday.
What happened?
I met Lavery in the street here. He said he didn't know where Crystal was. Hadn't seen her in 2 months. And hadn't gone away with her.
And you believed him?
Oh, I know these tomcats, Marlowe.
She might have got tired of him and tossed him out.
Well, you'll have to prove it. Marlowe, I have a good job here, but a job is all it is. I have no private money. I can't stand a scandal.
What kind of a scandal?
Well, Crystal is wild. She's pretty wild. She drinks too much. She steals things for thrills. She's a sucker for danger and the wrong man.
Well, this wire is a month old. If she got in trouble, you'd have heard.
Oh, you're making me feel better.
Too many other things could have happened to her. I'll start by talking to Lavery. Give me a photograph of your wife.
Well, this is the best I have. It's her and Lavery on the beach.
Oh, give me a note to your man, Bill Chess. I'll go up to the lake next. Don't say who I am. Just tell him to show me around.
One other thing. Now, 2 weeks ago, the Prescott Hotel in San Bernardino got in touch with me and said a Packard was unclaimed in their garage. It was Crystal's car. I sent him a check and told him to hold on to it.
She must have driven down there to catch the train to El Paso. Where does Lavery live?
Somewhere in Bay City. Miss Frompson will tell you. He worked for the company here at one time.
Mr. Kingsley, are you holding anything back? Anything important?
Marlowe, I just want to know where she is and if she's all right.
I'll find her. Lavery lived at 623 Altair Street. Miss Frompson told me. I had the impression that Chris Lavery was not a pleasant thought to her. Altair Street was to the north of Bay City, on the edge of the cool blue sweep of bay out to the point at Malibu. It was a short street with only 3 houses. One of them belonged to a Dr. Almore. Across from it was a bungalow, clinging like a vine to the hillside.
You make a hell of a lot of noise.
Mr. Lavery?
So?
I'm working for Mr. DeRace Kingsley.
The hell with both of you.
Ah, don't be childish. You know I'm going to talk to you, and you're going to talk to me.
Hell. Come in, then. I was just on my way to the beach. Make it snappy.
Just tell me where she is, and then we won't be bothering you.
I don't need any private dicks today, or any day.
I'm paid to stay. Tell me about this telegraph.
I didn't go to El Paso with Crystal. I told Kingsley that.
Then why would she send a wire saying she was going to marry you?
I haven't the faintest idea.
You didn't have any idea of marrying her?
She has money, but it would be too tough a way to make it.
Yeah. Kingsley doesn't care if you do run off with his wife. He just wants to feel sure that she isn't in trouble.
What kind of trouble?
Well, this wire has to mean something.
She was always full of tricks. I was supposed to run up there. To the lake? I didn't. I was sick of her.
I'd like it better if you did go to El Paso and split up there. Could you tell it that way?
I told you I didn't. Can't you remember that?
I'll remember it when I believe it.
Go climb up your thumb. Take the air. You're wasting my time and your own.
What line of business are you in, Lavery?
I'm expecting a commission in the Navy any day.
You ought to do well at that.
So long, Snooper, and don't bother to come back.
I may have to come back.
You still think I'm lying?
I think you've something on your mind. Thanks for your help. I sat outside of my Chrysler, listening to my new radio, trying to decide whether it was worth hiring somebody to tail Avery. I decided it wasn't. A thin man in dark glasses got out of a black Cadillac across the street and went up the path to the doctor's house. He carried a doctor's bag. He stopped to stare at me before he went in. Then he came to the window and stared at me, went away, came back, and stared at me again. This was interesting, if at all, only because he was a doctor. Doctors, as a rule, are the least curious of men. They've heard it all. But Dr. Almore was more than interested in me. He was bothered. Next time he came to the window, he was talking into a telephone. Then he sat down, as if waiting. I waited with him. For no reason at all. Doctors look out of their front windows. Doctors frown. Doctors have things on their minds and show the strain. Doctors are just people, born to sorrow, fighting the long, grim fight like the rest of us. It took about 5 minutes.
You just parked here, or are you waiting for somebody?
So that's the answer to the pantomime, huh?
What pantomime?
Nervous Nelly on the telephone, calling the cops.
Let me see your driver's license.
You fellows ever flash a badge, or is acting tough all the identification you need?
If I have to get tough, fella, you'll know it. DeGarmo, Detective Lieutenant.
Pleased to meet you, Lieutenant. Here's both my licenses.
A beeper. Tell me why you're down here casing Dr. Almore's place.
I never heard of Dr. Almore.
What's your grift, then? We don't like peepers in Bay City.
Is that so?
Talk it up. Did her folks hire you?
No. Never heard of her, either.
The last boy that tried it ended up on the road gang.
Tried what?
Tried to put the bite on.
Well, he looks like an easy man to bite.
You want to ride down to headquarters?
I'm not interested in Dr. Almore. I'm here visiting a friend and looking at the view.
Straight goods?
Straight goods.
Almore's screwy. He ought to see a doctor. Stay off our reservation and you won't make enemies. Go on. Beat it.
San Bernardino baked and shimmered in the afternoon heat. I stopped long enough to buy a pint of liquor in case I fainted before I got to the mountains, and started up the long grade to Crestline and Puma Lake, thinking about what Kingsley had told me on the phone about Dr. Almore. He had been Crystal's doctor for a while, and his wife had committed suicide over a year ago. It still didn't give me a reason to be interested. Puma Lake Dam had an armed sentry at each end and one in the middle. Beyond these details, the war didn't seem to have done anything much to it. Canoes and speedboats and fishermen were all over it. The landscape began to be full of girls in gaudy slacks and snoods and peasant handkerchiefs and rat rolls and fat-soled sandals and fat white thighs. A mile from the village, a road curved up into the mountains, signposted to Little Fawn Lake. Beyond a gate was a small oval lake, deep in trees, like a drop of dew caught in a curled leaf. At the near end was a rough concrete dam with a rope handrail along the top. Across the lake, there were three large redwood cabins, shut up and quiet. At the far end was what looked like a small jetty and a band pavilion. On my side was a smaller cabin, where I found Bill Chess.
This is Mr. Kingsley's cabin. It's been locked up since his wife was here a few weeks back. Take a look around. He ain't thinking of selling, is he?
Oh, everything's for sale in California.
Hey, ain't that the truth? It's a first-class cabin, you know. Bath, shower, stoves, range in the kitchen, a private reservoir in the hills for water.
How about electric light and telephone?
Oh, light, sure, but no phone. Did he say when Mrs. Kingsley would be back?
Why? Does she go at the cabin?
Hey, Jesus, if that ain't a kick in the pants.
Hey, the bed's comfortable, huh?
How would I know?
I don't know why you wouldn't know.
Look, I can smell you. I can smell a dick when I meet one. Did Kingsley hire you to come up here and see my wearing his pajamas, huh?
You're slipping your clutch.
Listen, I might have a stiff leg, but the women I could get...
I just came up here to see a cabin.
I'm sorry, Mr. Marlowe. I was out on the roof last night, and I got a hangover like seven Swedes. I've been up here alone for a month, and it's got me talking to myself. You know, a thing happened to me.
Anything a drink would help?
You got one?
I got a pint of rye in my pocket. Oh. They won't mind if we use their glasses.
Yeah, I don't deserve it, goddammit. I don't. Here we are.
Guess a guy can get the blues up here all alone, huh?
Yeah.
Here you are.
Thanks. Oh, man, that's from the right bottle. That sure helps. She left me a month ago. On Friday, the 12th of June, a day I'll remember. You don't want to hear about my troubles.
Oh, have another drink. It's none of my business, but I've got the time.
She was one swell kid. It was love at first sight with me and Muriel.
Muriel?
My wife.
Oh.
We got married a year ago. I met her in a bar. Love at first sight. But, you know how it is with a marriage. After a while, a guy like me, a common no-good guy like me, he wants to feel a leg.
Yeah, I've heard it happens.
Well, here I am, sitting pretty, no rent to pay, a pension, half my bonus money and war bonds, married to as neat a little blonde as you ever clapped eyes on. And all the time, I'm nuts and I don't even know it. I have to go for a showy little tart that means no more to me than a blade of grass. Right here in my own front yard.
You don't have to tell me.
You'd think I'd pick a change of type, at least. The little round heels here ain't even that. She's blonde, just like Muriel. Same size, same build, same type. And she's walking around where I can see her in peekaboo pajamas so thin I can see her nipples. She offers me a drink, and, I like a drink too well. Always been my trouble. Next thing, I'm in the house and the bottle's empty. The beds are comfortable.
Help yourself to this.
Why not? It doesn't matter now. Well, I come back across the dam. I'm as smooth as a new piston head. I'm getting away with something. Like hell I am. Muriel doesn't even raise her voice. She's telling me things about myself I didn't even imagine. I felt too mean to stay even half sober, so I drove over to a place north of here and got good and stinking with a couple of no-goods like myself. Along about 4 a.m., I got back, and Muriel is packed up and gone. Only a note that said, I'm sorry, Bill, but I'd rather be dead than live with you any longer, Muriel.
What happened to Mrs. Kingsley?
She must have packed up and gone down the same night. I ain't heard a word since. I don't have any idea where Muriel's at.
Oh, Mrs. Kingsley didn't go home.
What?
Her husband doesn't know where she is.
Here, you take your whiskey. I was right. You are a sleuth. The first guess is always right. Oh, boy, am I smart.
I didn't ask you to take your heart out and squeeze it for me.
Ah, the hell with you.
The hell with me. Any chance your wife and Mrs. Kingsley went off together?
Well, why should they?
Your wife would need a lift out of here.
Muriel had a car of her own. I have a Ford that's adapted for this stiff leg I got in the war. Is that straight goods at little round heels lammed off?
So it seems.
Boy, I bet she knew plenty of guys.
Any of them come up here? One named Lavery, for instance?
He was here, but it was quite a while ago. Sorry, I can't help you.
Well, you can show me around. What's that jetty and bandstand at the far end of the lake?
Well, a film company built them a few years ago for a movie. Now, I ain't been down there in a month. I got no reason to.
Movies, huh? Let's take a look. I had no reason to go down there. No reason to be interested. But it's my business to look at everything. We stood on the jetty. All we saw at first was an arm moving in the depths of the dark green water. Then Bill Chess smashed at the submerged planking with rocks until, in the turmoil of water, something loosened and rose slowly with an infinitely careless languor and broke surface. I saw wool, sodden and black, a leather jerkin, a pair of slacks, and something bulging nastily between the cuffs of the slacks and the shoes. I saw a wave of dark blonde hair straighten out in the water. Then a face, swollen, pulpy, without features, with a gold necklace with large green stones. When Bill Chess called out to his Muriel, his voice seemed to come to me from a long way off, over a hill, through a thick, silent growth of trees.
Patton's the name, son. Constable and deputy sheriff. What law we got around these little old mountains, I'm it. Until election time, anyways.
You're going to get a lot of publicity.
Oh, that's so.
If your jurisdiction extends to Little Fawn Lake...
Something bothering over there, son.
There's a dead woman in the lake. Muriel Chess. Looks like suicide. She left a note. Sounded as if she was just going away, but could be a suicide note as well. She's not nice to look at. Been in the water a month.
What's your connection?
Philip Marlowe. I'm up from L.A. to look at the property. Mr. Kingsley sent me.
How's Bill?
Half crazy with shock. He's there alone.
Oh. How much liquor has he got?
Only a drop I left.
Well, the county don't allow me no money for emergency liquor, so I just have to seize a little here and there. This should help him. A month, you said?
Yeah, seems they had a fight. Bill went off to get drunk. When he got back, she was gone.
Yeah. I never use liquor myself. Can't understand fellas letting themselves get all gummed up with it. Like old Bill. Just put that card up for me, will you, son?
Huh? Voters, attention. Keep Jim Patton constable. He is too old to go to work. Back in 20 minutes, maybe.
Let's get on up there, son. We'll bring along the doctor.
When we got back, Bill Chess was sitting naked with his head in his hands and the thing that had been a woman beside him. He dried himself and drank the whiskey and told his story. He was convinced Muriel had drowned herself. The note had said, "I'd rather be dead than live with you." The doctor could say nothing about the time or cause of death. The body had been in the water too long for that. Patton listened. I couldn't tell what he was thinking. He just chewed tobacco. He took Bill Chess back to town and held him for questioning. In the Indian Head Hotel at Puma Point, summer, that lovely season, was in full swing. I gobbled what they call the regular dinner, then drank a brandy to sit on its chest and hold it down. A thin, serious-looking girl came up to my table.
I'm Bertie Keppel. I'm the beautician here daytimes and evenings. I work on the Banner, our local paper.
She put out a firm brown hand and I shook it. Clamping bobby pins into fat blondes had given her a grip like a pair of iceman's tongs. I asked her to sit down.
Pleased to meet you, Mr. Marlowe. I hear you come from Hollywood, that sinful city.
You hear a lot.
Poor Muriel Chess. You found the body?
No, her husband did. Constable Patton will tell you all about it.
Oh, he's not around. What line of business are you in, Mr. Marlowe?
I'd rather not say.
We have an L.A. phone directory in our office. I looked you up. I haven't mentioned it to anyone.
What does that cost me?
Nothing. Do you have an interest in Muriel Chess?
Why should I?
About 6 weeks back, a Los Angeles copper named DeSoto came up here. A big roughneck. I didn't like him. Said he was looking for a woman called Mildred Haviland. Now, he had a photograph. It was an enlarged snapshot, not a police photo. It looked a good deal like Muriel Chess. Now, the hair seemed to be red and in a different style, and the eyebrows were plucked, and, well, that changes a woman a great deal. But it was like Muriel.
Well, what did you tell him?
Nobody in our office liked his manner. Anyway, why should we tell him?
Did he show you his badge?
Yeah, I don't recall he did.
Did anybody tell Muriel about this guy?
Well, that's why I want to tell you. I'm afraid I did.
What did she say?
She gave a funny little embarrassed laugh as if I'd made a bad joke and just walked away. Nobody knew her well or what she did before she came here. I kind of hope poor Bill Chess doesn't get in a nasty jam over this.
I don't know any more than you do. Say, when does the music start in this place, huh? DeRace Kingsley, when I phoned him, could tell me nothing new. I drove back up to Little Fawn Lake and, in the moonlight, pussyfooted around to the back of the Chess cabin and did a little breaking and entering. Then somebody put the lights on.
I'd rest right there, son. What's on your mind?
Well, I had an idea. I guess I can learn to forget it.
I heard your car. Didn't hear you, though. You walk right nice. There's a mess of detectives in the L.A. book, but only one called Marlowe. You didn't bother to tell me that yourself.
I'm sorry it bothered you.
Oh, I don't bother all that easy. I guess you aim to search the cabin.
Yeah.
I already pawed around considerable myself. Who hired you?
DeRace Kingsley, to trace his wife. She started from here, so I did too.
No interest in Bill Chess at all?
None.
Well, then why you want to search the cabin?
Bill Chess is the guy in trouble. If he didn't murder his wife, there might be something here to point that way.
Such as?
Well, if a woman plans to go away, she'll take a lot of personal stuff with her.
Muriel didn't go away.
Then the stuff should still be here.
It ain't.
Well, what about the car? Could he drive it with his stiff leg?
He could. And it ain't here.
It looks bad for Bill. He couldn't burn the car or bury it or abandon it in a town somewhere. So the best bet is that it's hid in the woods no further away than he could walk, with her personal stuff in it. It could still be suicide, though, if she hid it. A revenge suicide?
Uh-uh. That don't fit in with my simple idea of human nature. What I like is she did plan to go away, did write the note, but he was drunk. He caught her, saw red, and finished her off.
What kind of a girl was she?
Cute.
Did she look like Mildred Haviland?
Well, well. I'll be mighty careful to look under the bed before I crawl in tonight just to make sure you ain't there. Who told you that?
Bertie Keppel.
Oh. You know, DeSoto showed that picture to damn near everybody in town before he showed it to me, and that made me sore. So I made one of my mistakes. I told him I didn't know anybody looked like that. You done right nicely in your figuring, Marlowe. I found the car. Not far away, two suitcases, packed kind of hasty, and this.
Well, that's an anklet, a gold chain with a lock. Some women never take them off.
This one's been cut through. I found it here. It has a little gold heart, engraved.
To Mildred, June 28th, 1938, with all my love, Al.
I guess I owe that cop DeSoto an apology. Say, you look like you got an idea about this, too.
I'll bet you Bill Chess never knew his Muriel was really Mildred Haviland. Somebody out of her past found her. She died just 2 weeks after this DeSoto was looking for her.
Well, it'd have to be somebody who knew the country to hide the car the way they did.
She was persuaded to go away. The note was written. Then she was taken round the throat and put in the lake.
It's not impossible.
If you get tired of it, let me know.
Oh, I sure will, son. And maybe then you can tell me who that somebody was.
I drove down to the Prescott Hotel in San Bernardino and booked into a room that was a mite close-fitting. I went into the bathroom sideways and doused myself with tepid, cold water. It stopped the perspiration for about 2 minutes. By that time, the bellhop who had brought me up was back with the glasses and the ice. He was tall and not young and as cool as a slice of chicken in aspic. He took his drink and watched as I laid out a hand of dollar bills on the bed.
I beg your pardon, sir. I reckon you might be a cop.
You ever see a cop playing solitaire with his own money? Call me an investigator.
Now I'm interested, but I'm no use at remembering.
Oh, try a dollar on your mind. And can I call you Big Tex from Houston?
Amarillo, how do you like the Texas drawl? It makes me sick, but I find the people go for it.
Whatever makes a dollar.
Yeah, this is good rye. What can I do for you?
Friday, June 12th, late afternoon or evening.
I was here, on the 6 to 12 shift.
A blonde, pretty, driving a Packard registered to Crystal Kingsley. It's still in the hotel garage. She probably stayed just long enough to get the night train to El Paso. Thinking about it wins another dollar.
Thanks.
They go into your pocket with a sound like caterpillars fighting.
She ate dinner here. Didn't check in. Wore a black and white tailored suit, mostly white. She took a cab to the station.
Take a look at this photograph.
I couldn't swear. With a change of clothes and makeup and all, blondes can all look alike. You interested in the gent in the photograph with her?
Lavery? Was he here?
He spoke to her in the lobby. Then had dinner with her. Went off in the cab with her, too.
Anything else?
I got the impression she didn't like him just walking up to her so openly in the lobby like that.
Thanks. Well, here's a five for your time, Tex.
Y'all enjoy your stay here.
I wouldn't stay here if you paid me. I'm going back to Hollywood where it's cooler. I dreamed I was far down in the depths of icy green water with a corpse under my arm. I was going to burst from lack of air. I woke up with a mouthful of sheet and both hands hooked on the bed frame and pulling hard. I felt better when I had some breakfast. The photograph I had of Crystal showed her on the beach with Chris Lavery. Dames do look different on the beach. I called headquarters and asked for Mr. DeSoto. They had no record of a cop called DeSoto. Then I reported to my client and set off for Bay City to pay another call on Lavery. When I got there, the door was open. Inside was a strange-looking woman, wearing too much makeup, with brown hair and a purple hat. She also had a gun, pointed at me. I kept looking at the gun and not screaming.
All I wanted was my rent. He was always a good, tidy, careful tenant. I just didn't want him to get too far behind in the rent.
How far behind is he?
3 months, $240. That's very reasonable, you know, for a place like this. He promised me a check this morning over the telephone.
And you are the owner?
Who did you think I was?
I thought you might be the owner.
I'm Mrs. Fallbrook.
How do you do?
Stand still.
Ma'am.
Who are you, if I may inquire?
I just came about the car payment.
Is he behind with those payments, too? Oh, it's easier for you. You can take the car back. It takes time and money to evict a tenant. And I walked over here, too, to save my tires for the government. Oh, will you take this gun, please? It's put oil on my glove.
Thanks. I'll take it.
It's funny. I found it on the stairs. Has it been fired?
Any reason why it should?
People do.
Is Mr. Lavery not home?
No, I don't think that's very nice of him. He promised me a check.
Mrs. Fallbrook, let's not kid around anymore, huh? Not that I don't love it. This gun is empty. It has been fired. You didn't shoot him, did you, on account of the rent?
What a perfectly horrid suggestion.
Did you look around?
I just called out.
Let's look around.
This is my house.
Is it your gun?
I found it on the stairs.
That's your story.
Yeah.
I don't have to get stuck with it.
I'll thank you to leave.
You shouldn't have let me find out the gun was empty.
How dare you?
Up to then, you held all the cards.
How dare you be so insulting?
I'm not even trying.
I won't stay in this house another moment with you.
Something is all wrong with this scene. Lavery? Lavery? Chris Lavery hadn't slept alone. There was a pair of sheer black pajamas flung on the bed, makeup on the dressing table, women's clothes in the closet, including a black and white tailored suit, mostly white. The bathroom door was locked, so I opened it and smelt that pungent smell. There were two bullet holes in the plaster by the window and one in the frosted glass, and two holes in Lavery where he lay in the bottom of the shower. She has a gun. You look at the gun and she shoots it. She misses with the first three shots. It seems impossible at such close range, but there it is. Maybe it happens all the time. I've been around so little. You haven't anywhere to go. You could lunge at her and take a chance if you're that kind of a fellow, but you're apt to be somewhat petrified with panic if you are at all like other people. So you back up into the shower stall, but you are all out of space and out of living. And then there are two more shots and you slide down the wall and your eyes are not frightened anymore. I touched him. He couldn't have been colder or stiffer. Back in the bedroom, I found a woman's handkerchief under the pillow. It was initialed AF. Adrienne Fromset? I took it with me. I found nothing else to interest me. Outside, it was quiet and sunny and calm. It's only Marlowe finding another body. Murderer Day Marlowe, they call him. A nice enough fellow in his ingenious sort of way. With a client to protect. DeRace Kingsley.
Marlowe. Marlowe, over here.
Mr. Kingsley.
Sit down, Marlowe. And, keep your voice down. The library in this club is strictly for after-luncheon naps. Now, what's the problem? When I hired you, it was to save me trouble, not to add to what I already had. You made me break an important engagement.
She shot him.
What?
Lavery had a woman with him last night. This morning, she shot him in the bathroom.
My God, why in the bathroom?
Keep your own voice down. Why not?
Well, Are you sure it was a woman?
No. You might have shot him.
I'm a civilized man.
Does your wife own a gun?
Well, yes, but... Oh, my God. It's a small automatic.
Is this it? Sorry, sir.
Well, it's like it. I don't remember the serial number.
I was hoping you wouldn't. It would have worried me very much if you had.
Oh, that bastard Lavery. I suppose he ditched her, and she couldn't stand it.
Well, the motive wasn't enough for you, on account of you're a civilized man. But it was enough for her.
Oh, women are more impetuous than men.
I need a better motive.
Marlowe, this gun is registered to Crystal. Now, we can't let the police have it.
The landlady was there, looking for the rent. She may tell them.
Will she?
She found only the gun, not a body. She may just forget the whole thing. She was an odd dame.
We have to take the chance. I'll make it worth your while.
I can't cover up a murder, even for a $5 bonus.
I was thinking of 500.
Just what did you expect to buy with it?
Oh, I can't believe Crystal did this. Is there any other evidence that she was there?
A black and white suit like the one she was said to be wearing in San Bernardino? Maybe fingerprints? What kind of perfume did she use?
Gillerlane Regal, of course. The champagne of perfumes.
The bedroom reeks of it.
Reeks? We get $30 an ounce for it.
Smelled more like $3 a gallon.
Marlowe, I hired you to protect me and my wife if she needed it.
Judging by the cop I met down there, they'll just pick the first head they see and start swinging their blackjacks. Hers will be the first head.
Oh, God, it's hard to believe she could be so dumb, leave so much evidence.
Well, you said she was impetuous, reckless, foolish. It's a crime of passion. All I can do is go down there, replace the gun, and call the law. At worst, they proved she killed him. At best, they'll find her a lot quicker than I can and let me use my energies to prove she didn't. Are you game for that?
Prove it, and the 500 is yours.
Okay. How well did your secretary, Miss Fromsett, know Lavery?
What's all this to do with her?
You tell me.
Oh, he worked for us. She knew him. Rather well, then, not now.
Are you in love with her?
Oh, I'd marry her tomorrow if I could.
Well, you're honest about it. Gives you a lot of motives.
She knew all those people. Dr. Almore, Almore's wife.
I'll have to talk to her. If you hear from the cops, you don't know Lavery is dead. You didn't talk to me. They must think I've just discovered him when I call in. Don't fall into any traps.
You can trust me. I can handle it.
Then we'll go. I can see why they call this place the Athletic Club. Miss Fromsett, do you wear the firm's perfume?
Yes. If you want to know, I detest wearing it in the office, but DeRace makes me.
Did he tell you why he hired me?
Yes. If you knew what he has suffered from that wife of his... Perhaps I ought to leave that out. DeRace is a great person.
Do you know the Almores?
I met Mrs. Almore a couple of times.
At Lavery's house?
I don't think that's any of your business.
I think it is.
Yes, at his house. But Mrs. Almore's dead. She committed suicide 18 months ago.
Any doubt about that?
Well... Have you any particular reason for asking these questions?
Almore was nervous enough to put a plainclothes cop on me for sitting outside his door. And the cop thought it smart to say that the last fellow who tried to put the bite on ended up on the road gang. If you can tell me why, I'll have a reason.
At that time when I knew Chris, he threw a party, very mixed. Florence Almore was there. She was one of those slinky, glittering females who laugh too much. A man was ribbing her about her husband's practice, how he was one of those doctors who ran around all night with a case of loaded hypodermic needles to keep the local fast set from having pink elephants for breakfast. She said she didn't care how he got his money so long as he got plenty. Then somebody asked her how he got hold of so much dope without underworld contacts. She got mad, made a scene. A few weeks later, Chris, coming home late at night, found her dead in a closed garage with a car engine running. It was hushed up in the papers.
Was it suicide?
She made another scene at Lou Condy's club, so the gossip said.
Condy would be the right connection.
Condy called the doctor. He gave her a needle to quieten her, then went on his rounds. Condy took her home, and she was put to bed by the doctor's nurse. She had to be carried there. But the same night, she got up and walked down to the garage, and then there was a cover-up.
Meaning Al Moore finished her off? To protect himself?
Her parents hired a private detective. But he got arrested for drunk driving.
And ended up on the road gang. Did Lavery know all this?
I'd like to think blackmail was one of the nasty little tricks that Chris didn't quite run to. I think that's all I can tell you, Mr. Marlowe.
Recognize this handkerchief?
The initials happen to be the same as mine.
I found it in Lavery's bed today.
So you're going to be nasty after all.
Is it yours?
Yes. But I must have dropped it there a long time ago. He probably lent it to another woman. Or several other women.
That's not a nice thing to say about a dead man.
Chris. Chris is dead?
Shot by the woman who spent the night there.
When?
This morning, when he got up.
He always got up late. I was here at 8:30.
I didn't think you shot him.
Women make such ghastly mistakes about men. The poor, selfish, cheap, nasty, handsome, treacherous guy. Dead and cold and done. Do the police know? Does Durace know about this handkerchief?
No. Only us and whoever put it there. You're not the kind of a girl who leaves her hanky under a man's pillow. You have too much dignity.
Nice of you to think so.
I can be nice as well as nasty.
Who did kill him?
Crystal Kingsley's clothes are there.
So Durace couldn't be spared even that.
It could be something different. It could be connected with Almore.
I don't see how. What about the handkerchief?
Wash it. He probably had a drawer full of Dame's hankies.
Thanks.
You can trust me. Well, I'd better go off now and discover the body.
I'm Captain Weber. This is Lieutenant DeGarmo. So, you're a private eye from L.A., Marlowe. That means everything will be all balled up. You know this Lavery guy? Onto him for something?
Working on him a little.
Who handled the gun?
I did.
All balled up. Didn't you know any better?
When I handled it, I didn't know there was a crime. I found it on the stairs.
He found it? On the stairs? Get this straight, Marlowe. You're from the big town. You think you're tough, wise. Don't worry, we can handle you. There's no political tug of war, not down here, not in Bay City. Don't worry about us.
Look, Chief, Lavery was a chaser. I mean, the whole setup indicates a dame. Private eyes do divorce stuff. Suppose we let him tie into this, instead of trying to scare him.
If I'm scaring him, I don't see any sign of it. Talk to him, DeGarmo. I'll go upstairs and see what the deputy coroner's got.
Am I supposed to tell about our conversation yesterday, DeGarmo? Or was that a private transaction?
Talk about it all you like. I was protecting a citizen. It's my job.
Dr. Almore.
You said you didn't know him.
That was yesterday. Before I knew the story that was wrapped up and hidden on the back of the shelf. That Lavery found Mrs. Almore and might have been into blackmail, which would be a motive for his murder. Anything in the idea that Almore murdered his wife and had enough pull with someone to get it fixed?
Say that again.
You'll hit me again.
Say it again.
Did he have enough pull with someone to get it fixed?
Say it again.
No, you might miss.
Anytime you talk like that to a cop, you know what you got coming.
You'll wake up in an alley with a cat's looking at you.
I'll remember that.
Hey, you two. What's going on here?
Nothing.
Just making friends.
Okay. Now, Marlowe, tell me what you found here and why. And don't leave anything out.
The second drink out of the office bottle didn't do me any more good than the first. The third wasn't any improvement. The early neon lights cast a glow over my office. By now, Weber would have seen Kingsley and a general alarm would be out for his wife. All cut and dried. A nasty affair between two rather nasty people. Too much loving, too much drinking, too much proximity, ending in a savage hatred, a murderous impulse, and death. I thought it was too simple. I opened my mail. There was a note from Adrian Fromset, delivered by hand. If it was any help, she said, here was the address of Florence Almore's parents. I washed my hands and bathed my face in cold water. The flush was gone from the left cheek, but it looked a little swollen. I looked at the gray in my hair. There was getting to be plenty of gray in it. The face under the hair had a sick look. I didn't like the face at all. I went back to the desk and sat very still and listened to the evening grow quiet outside the open windows. And very slowly, I grew quiet with it. Then I went to talk to two old people who thought their daughter had been murdered, but who hadn't been able to find out a thing about it. The cops in Bay City had not exactly been cooperative. They told me a story of a doctor who made his money out of dispensing dope to people living on the raw edge of nervous collapse, not caring what kind of hopeless addicts they might become, so long as he got paid. How he was having an affair with his nurse. How, after his wife died, they hired a private detective called Tally, who was given a doped drink in a bar while he was drinking with a cop, and how a police car was waiting for him as soon as he drove away. To old people, with a wild, dead daughter sitting there poisoning their minds with suspicions and hate, and no proof. As I was leaving, I thought to ask them the name of Al Moore's nurse, the one who had put their daughter to bed the night she died. They told me the nurse's name was Mildred. Mildred Haviland. Good evening, ma'am. Is Mr. Tally in?
Who wants him?
Are you Mrs. Tally?
I can't pay, mister.
I just want to talk to your husband. I got something for him.
That sounds familiar. He had something, too, once.
He can have it again, if he plays his cards right.
If that's what it takes, you can scratch him off right now. He won't be here again. I'm tired. I'm so damn tired. Beat it, mister.
Would a little money help?
Smell it. Come in here, mister. Come in and smell it. Smell the cigar smoke. They've been here 2 hours, asking and waiting. I'm tired. Tired of old cops. Tired.
Mrs. Tally,
I have nothing to tell you. I wouldn't tell you if I had. I live here in Bay City, mister, if you call it living. Anyway, it's the nearest I can get to living. I want a little peace and quiet. Go away, or I'll start yelling my head off now.
All right, Mrs. Tally. Look, I'll leave you a card. Call me if you change your mind, please. Stepped on the gas, but the other car was gaining on me. I was on the wrong side of town, factories and junkyards. I didn't care about getting away. I wanted to get back to houses and people who might see and remember what was going to happen. I didn't make it. They pulled alongside and then cut in.
Okay, mister. Out of that car. Don't you know a police siren when you hear one? Out. Let me see your driver's license. Marlowe. A Seamus. You think of that, Cooney.
Is that all? Guess I won't need this gun.
Guess I can handle this with my little flippers. Smell the bastard's breath.
Breathe. Well, he ain't staggering. I gotta admit that.
It's a cold night. Buy the boy a drink from this, Dobbs.
Suppose I don't want a drink.
Then we might think you wanted footprints on your stomach.
Here's the bottle. Have a drink.
You can't work the same gag all the time, boys. You insist I drink this?
Yeah. Why, you bastard! Hold it, Marlowe.
Stay on the ground, Peeper.
Jesus. I'm bleeding. I'm bleeding. This is my blood. Let me at him.
Now take it easy, Cooney. We got what we want. Oh,
just give me 1 minute with him. I gotta see more blood. I gotta see his blood.
Leave him. We got enough. You drive his car.
I'll tear every goddamn fender off it.
Get up, Marlowe. You're coming with me. You shouldn't have hit that police officer.
He attacked me. I was defending myself.
Resisting arrest. And HBD.
HBD?
Had been drinking. Plenty got spilled on you.
I thought they'd clean this town up so that a decent man could walk around tonight without wearing a bulletproof vest.
Not too clean. Might scare away a dirty dollar.
Talk like that, you might lose your union card.
You think this is my idea of a good time? Now, what the hell? I'll be in the army in 2 weeks. Now, let's move. We got a new jail here, and you'll like it.
It was new, in the nice new city hall in Nice Bay City. People who lived here thought it was a nice city. They saw the nice blue bay and the yacht harbor and the nice, quiet old houses. They wouldn't think about the Mexican and Negro slums or the waterfront dives along the flat south shore of their cliffs. The sweaty dance halls, the marijuana joints, the narrow fox faces watching over the tops of newspapers and hotel lobbies, the pickpockets and grifters, the con men and drunk rollers, the pimps and queens on the boardwalk. It was 9:44. Time to go home and get your slippers on and play over a game of chess with a tall, cool drink. Time to be a human being. A man with nothing to do but rest and rebuild the brain for tomorrow. A cop came along and gave me the hard stare which says, "I'm a cop, brother. I'm tough. Watch your step or we'll fix you so you won't crawl out on your hands and knees. Let's go, brother, and let's not forget. We do what we like with punks like you. We're tough."
DeGarmo here has brought me the report on you, Marlowe. Seems you asked for trouble and you got it. Or are my men lying, as usual?
Chief.
Well, Marlowe?
It's going to take a little frank talk to explain, Captain Weber.
I kind of specialize in frank talk.
Your men were waiting for me at George Talley's house. Talley used to be a private eye down here. DeGarmo knows why I wanted to see him, don't you, DeGarmo?
Maybe.
You're a stupid man, DeGarmo. Everything you do is stupid. You had to get tough outside Almore's house when there was nothing to get tough about. You made me curious.
What has this to do with Almore?
Talley worked on the Almore case until he got pinched for HBD and driving.
The Almore case was before I came here. I don't know who stuck the first knife into Julius Caesar either. Make your point.
DeGarmo knows about the case. I was afraid the same thing might happen to me tonight.
DeGarmo, did you get made chief of police today? You might have let me in on it. Did you put Cooney and Dobbs over there?
That was nothing. We were kidding. I don't see why we have to put up with these snoopers coming into town and stirring up a lot of dead leaves. He's just trying to promote himself a job, take a couple of old people for their money, like Tally tried.
Is that how it looks to you?
How else?
I think you need a little air. Would you please take it? Now, Lieutenant?
You mean, you want me to breeze on out?
Would you be so kind?
Captain, your plan is wrong.
Let me decide. Drift.
All right.
You weren't booked, Marlowe. You're free to go. You want to file charges?
Life's too short for me to be filing charges of assault against the police.
Police business is a hell of a problem. It's a good deal like politics. It asks for the highest type of men, and there's nothing in it to attract the highest type of men. So we have to work with what we get, and we get things like this.
I've always known that.
I suppose some people think we're just a bunch of crooks. I suppose they think a fella kills his wife and then calls me up and says, "Hi, Cap, I got a little number down here cluttering up the front room, and I got 500 bucks that are not working." And I say, "I'll be right down with a hearse." What did you want to see Tally for?
He had a line on Florence Almore's death.
Tally was nothing, a cheap blackmailer. I'll tell you what he had. A slipper. Brand new.
Hey, I'm beginning to get it. The walk from the house to the garage is rough concrete. If a slipper on the body had never been scuffed, then she was carried. Who was in charge of the investigation?
I think you know.
When DeGarmo got there, was the slipper missing?
Not according to the police report. We only have Tally's word he took it off the body. He could have stolen the slipper from the house. I can't prove anything.
Unless the nurse was involved?
Why the hell would she?
She was having an affair with the doctor.
She'd been gone from around here since then.
Now that brings me to a real basic coincidence. A woman named Muriel Chess was found drowned in a mountain lake yesterday. Only you wouldn't know her as Muriel Chess, but as Mildred Haviland.
The nurse?
She may have been scared into leaving town. Now this is the coincidence. She married a guy who looked after a lake property owned by a man, Kingsley, whose wife was intimate with Lavery. And Lavery could have been blackmailing Almore.
It's one hell of a coincidence.
It's fundamental. Everything else flows from it.
How can you be sure this lady in the lake was the nurse?
A few weeks ago, a tough guy was up there showing a photo around of Mildred Haviland. He said he was an L.A. cop, but his description would fit DeGarmo. Nobody liked his manner, so they didn't tell him anything, but they told the girl, Muriel, and she reacted scared. Also, a gold anklet was hidden in the chest cabin. It had a heart on it, engraved, to Mildred, June 28, 1938, with all my love, Al.
Al. Al DeGarmo.
What?
Al was married to Mildred Haviland. As she led him a dance, a lot of what seems bad in him is a result of it.
I'm beginning to see things I didn't know existed.
She had a way with the men. She could make them crawl over her shoes. She divorced DeGarmo, but that didn't end it for him.
Does he know she's dead?
I don't know. But if you think he went up there to hurt her, you're as wet as a bar towel.
I never thought that. Whoever killed her knew the country up there. But it was somebody out of her past.
Marlowe, this is all between us. I'd like you to keep it that way.
Well, I can't promise you. I'm being paid to try to prove that Crystal Kingsley did not shoot Lavery and that she has disappeared because she was frightened. I think it's legitimate to try.
If you can find proof that'll stand up in court. Till then, I can't help you try to put something on one of my boys.
You can find Crystal Kingsley.
That, you can be sure, we'll try.
Marlowe.
It's almost midnight. Where the hell have you been?
Kingsley?
Yes. I've been trying to reach you for hours.
Well, I'm here now. What is it?
I've heard from Crystal.
When?
Can you be at my place in 5 minutes?
I'm on my way.
Where were you?
In jail. Good evening, Miss Fromsett.
You look bad, Marlowe. What happened to you?
The Bay City Police gave me a little present.
Well, you'll have to go back there right now. Now, here. Take this $500 to Crystal. She has to get out of that town.
Has her own bank account got locked, jaw?
Well, she's in trouble. Now, she said she'd meet whoever was bringing the money in the Crystal Lounge on 8th Street.
Well, what else did she say?
I talked to her when she called. Derace was being interviewed by the police. I asked if he could call her back, but she wouldn't give a number.
I don't want to talk to her or even see her. I guess she must be guilty.
Maybe. I don't like her knowing the cops are after her. Was she listening to the police shortwave just for amusement?
When she called back, she asked for money.
Did she sound scared?
No, completely calm. She had it all worked out. She said she'd come in the lounge every hour and asked who would bring the money. I Guess I assumed it would be you, so I described you and said you'd wear this yellow scarf at DeRace's. It's sort of conspicuous.
You've got a hell of a crust, Kingsley. Assuming I'll take a getaway stake to somebody the police are after.
I admit it's a bit thick, but will you do it?
It could make us all accessories to murder.
She may not have done anything.
I'm willing to suppose that. Otherwise, I wouldn't be talking to you. But if I then decide she has, I'll turn her in.
She won't talk to you.
She will. She wants this money.
There's another thing. She's dyed her hair brown.
Try to help her if you can. You're a pretty level guy, Marlowe.
Tell that to the cops in Bay City. I have to go back there. And you can see this scarf a mile away. Were you blind when you bought it?
May I sit down?
Sure, lady.
Do you have something for me?
Depends who you are.
You know who I am, Mr. Yellow Scarf. How much did you bring?
500.
Not nearly enough.
It was all he could raise.
I've been waiting here an eternity. It's after 1 a.m.
You're pretty cool.
Don't waste my time.
Not like I heard about you.
Give me the money.
Talk first.
We don't have to talk.
I'm taking quite a risk.
Why couldn't they do it right?
You have to talk to me or the law.
Who are you?
A private detective.
Isn't my dear husband charming?
It wasn't easy for him to know what to do.
Just give me the money.
No talk, no money.
What do you want to know?
Where you've been, what you expect to do.
Let me work things out for myself.
No talk, no money.
Not here. I'm at the Granada Hotel, room 618. It's 2 blocks north. Give me 2 minutes, then follow me. Help yourself.
Thanks. You know, I had quite a different impression of you from Kingsley and Lavery, too.
I've dyed my hair.
It makes quite a difference.
You were hired to look for me. You found me. Get on with it.
You sent a wire from El Paso. Did you marry Lavery?
I changed my mind. I sent him away.
What did you do then?
I went to Santa Barbara for a week, then Pasadena, then Hollywood, then here.
Alone?
Yes.
What was the idea?
I had to think things out. My life was in a hopeless tangle.
You spent a month at Little Fawn Lake trying to do that.
I guess I needed more time. Please, won't you give me the money and go away?
Did you come here to see Lavery?
I'm in love with him, and yet I don't want to marry him. I told you, I'm all mixed up.
Yeah. No other reason for leaving the lake? Muriel Chess, for instance?
Her? Why?
Bill Chess claims you invited him in to help pass the lonely hours.
Oh, that drunk?
And now Muriel has been found drowned in the lake. Probably drowned the night you left.
God, I'm not too surprised. So it came to that in the end.
What?
Oh, they fought terribly at times. I had nothing to do with it at all.
Doesn't seem to bother you much.
I hardly knew Muriel.
Didn't you know her as Mildred?
Hmm?
Didn't you recognize her as Dr. Almore's nurse? You were his patient.
Only for a while, and he always came to the house.
Muriel Chess was Mildred Haviland. His office nurse.
Was she? What a queer coincidence.
Didn't Lavery recognize her when he was up at the lake?
He never gave any sign that he did. Perhaps she stayed away from him. I hardly spoke to her. Poor Mildred.
Yeah. You know, you did the Mrs. Fallbrook character very well.
Hmm?
Looking back, I think it was a shade overdone, but I fell for it. It was when you put the gun in my hand. That convinced me. But why take the risk of going back to Lavery's place in broad daylight?
You think I shot him?
I know you did.
He had all my money. He stripped my purse. It wasn't a risk. I disguised myself a little, went there, took in the milk and papers, all very normal. People lose their heads in these situations, but I don't. I don't see why I should. It's much safer not to.
People have been making a bad mistake about you.
Really?
They've been thinking of you as reckless, with no brains. So, you shot him the night before. I should have thought of that. He would shave at night for his lady friends.
What are you going to do about it?
Turn you over to the police with pleasure.
I gave you an empty gun that day. I could afford to. I have another one here.
I never liked this scene. Detective confronts murderer. Murderer produces gun, points same at detective, tells him the whole sad story with the idea of shooting him at the end of it, thus wasting a lot of valuable time. The gods don't like the scene either. They always manage to spoil it.
I've no story to tell you. You don't seem to be afraid.
You'll probably miss me. You missed Lavery 3 times.
I won't. I'm going to be too close to miss. This close. Hold your hands up by your shoulders and then don't move at all.
Are you going to search me? I haven't got a gun. You don't know much about them, do you? What with your bad aim and standing far too close to me, and though I hate to bring it up, you've forgotten to take the safety catch off.
What? Oh, you bastard!
I told you the gods didn't like this scene. Leave the gun on the floor, lady. Let's talk some more. Hotel room. There was a lady with a gun and somebody hit you from behind. Where did he come from? Man, you stink of gin. They poured gin on you. Oh. In a hotel room, a girl that had been blonde with hair dyed brown. I'm not wearing all my clothes or my shoes. Where is she? Oh, Jesus. Marlowe, you have been set up. She is on the bed. She is naked, except for tan stockings, and they make her seem more naked. And she has been strangled. And she has 4 deep scratches on her belly, gouged by 4 bitter fingernails. I gotta get out. Gotta get my coat on. Got to. Gotta put on my shoes. What do I have to remember? I must remember the scarf, the yellow scarf, and the money. The money? Where's the envelope of the money? When are they coming to get me? And can I get out first?
Open up! This is the police! Open up or we kick it in! Hold it right there. Well, I'm damned. Marlowe, a sex killer.
DeGarmo, you can't... You won't get away with this. Not even if you took me down to City Hall instead of driving me up here into the hills.
I've got nothing to lose. Weber suspended me.
How did you know I was in that hotel room with her?
A call came in. I was hanging around at headquarters. Some guy disguised his voice and didn't give a name. I got there first. Hey, you got a real bump on the back of your head.
I was sapped. What do you want, DeGarmo?
Let's hear you talk, Marlowe. Maybe we can work this out. Smoke?
Thanks. Weber's only 1 jump behind us.
To hell with Weber. If I can crack this Lavery case, I'll get by with a reprimand. If I don't... I'll be thumbing a ride out of town. Help me. Tell me what you know.
Okay. Kingsley told me he got a call from his wife.
Uh-huh.
She wanted money. He sent me to give it to her.
Money? For a getaway? He knew she was wanted in connection with Lavery's murder. So did you.
I wanted to talk to her. I met her in the Crystal Lounge. Her hair was dyed. I didn't recognize her, but I had only seen a photograph. I said, talk or no money. So we went to that hotel. She went first, alone.
Time for her guy to plant himself behind the curtains and wait.
He was behind the curtains, but I'm not sure she knew about it.
No? Get any kind of a look at him?
No.
Too bad.
Yeah.
I think she knew.
Maybe. I found this yellow scarf lying among the clothes.
You think the guy dropped it?
I've seen Kingsley wear it.
Kingsley? Well, I'm damned. Now, why would Kingsley kill her?
She was cheating on him, making trouble. She had money, he didn't. He wanted to marry his secretary. And what if Lavery's murder wasn't proved against her, and she got off to make more trouble? Also, there was a chance to set me up as the goat.
Where's Kingsley's place?
Beverly Hills.
He better be there. And he better be able to account for where he's been tonight. Keep that scarf in your pocket till we want to spring it on him.
Whatever you say, Lieutenant.
One moment, please, gentlemen. Whom did you wish to see?
Did he say whom?
Yeah, but don't hit him. There is such a word.
I knew there was. I often wondered where they kept it.
We want apartment 716, Miss Fromm said. Any objections?
I most certainly have. We don't announce guests at 23 minutes past 4 in the morning.
That's what I thought, so I wasn't going to bother you. I'm a police lieutenant. Here's the badge.
Oh, very well. I hope there isn't going to be any trouble. I better announce you then.
Do that.
Marlowe, you think he'll be here?
He wasn't at his home.
Miss Fronson, it's the desk. Two gentlemen...
Lieutenant DeGarmo and Mr. Marlowe.
Lieutenant DeGarmo.
Would this dame cover for him?
I don't know.
Oh, very well, Miss Fronson. I'll send them up. She will receive you.
Thanks, sweetheart.
She must have been awake. At 24 past 4 in the morning.
Durace isn't here. He hasn't been.
Do you know where we might find him?
Isn't that urgent?
Something has happened, Miss Fromsett.
What?
She's been murdered.
Murdered?
So just tell us where he is, sister.
I suppose I ought to cry or something, but I don't seem to feel anything at all.
You can understand why Kingsley has to be found.
Why?
Skip the attitudes. Maybe you think we should keep it a secret from him.
Is it just because he has to be told?
He wasn't at his house. This scarf was found in the hotel room where she was murdered. I think you have seen it, haven't you? Just tell me that you have.
You ask for a great deal of confidence, Mr. Marlowe, considering that you haven't been such a smart detective.
I ask you for that confidence. I expect to get it. And how smart I've been is something you don't really know anything about. Is it Kingsley's scarf?
Yes, you know it is.
This is cute. You two make a nice team. All you need is acrobats to follow you.
How was she murdered?
Stripped naked, scratched up, and strangled.
Durace wouldn't have done anything like that.
Sister, nobody ever knows what anybody else will do. Where is he?
He didn't bring me home. I took a taxi about 5 minutes after Mr. Marlowe left.
Well, usually the bim tries to give her boyfriend a bit more alibi than that.
He wanted to bring me home, but we were both tired. He doesn't need an alibi. He couldn't have known where to go, what hotel she was in.
He had the time.
Is this the kind of confidence you ask for?
We're getting nowhere. Let's go.
I'm not finished. If Kingsley had something on his mind, where might he go to be quiet to figure it out?
He wouldn't run away.
But he might want time to himself.
You're getting nowhere. Let's go.
Let me use your phone.
It's there.
Hold it. Tell me who you're calling.
Operator, I want a person-to-person call to Constable Jim Patton at Puma Point. It's urgent.
Who's running this show?
I am. This is Tunbridge 2722. Unless you want the L.A. police to run it, you have no jurisdiction outside Bay City.
Well, what's at Puma Point?
Kingsley has a cabin up there. I'm going to ask Patton to go over there and see if he can spot him. He's no cold killer. I think he might give himself up soon. It would look better for you if you got to him before he did.
Make the call. We'll go up there. You and me. What the hell are we stopping for?
They've got sentries guarding the Puma Lake Dam.
Against what?
Submarines. There's a war on, haven't you heard?
That doesn't bother me just now. I want this case finished, closed, dead.
Close all the windows of your car before proceeding across the dam, please.
Forget it, buddy. Let us through. I'm a police officer.
Close all the windows, please, sir.
Nuts to you, soldier boy.
Look, I didn't write the orders, mister. I just obey them. Up with the windows.
They give kids rifles. They think they're God Almighty. Three of them sitting along this dam, all linked up by phone. Think they're big shots. That was my girl that drowned up at Little Fawn Lake. I haven't been right in the head since I heard about it. All I can see is red.
We have to leave the car and walk to the lake from here. Patton will be waiting. He said Kingsley was inside the cabin. What's that?
A 38 Smith & Wesson and a 44 frame?
He's not that kind of tough. It's not a tiger hunt. You won't need the artillery.
Are you carrying a gun, Marlowe?
No.
Good. This is enough gun for both of us.
Oh, you are a little crazy, DeGarmo.
What do you mean?
You made enough trouble. It all goes back to Florence Almore. She didn't get up and walk down to that garage to commit suicide. She was carried. Almore gave her an injection which made her sleep, but he didn't murder her. Morphine would be the last thing a doctor like him would use. Somebody else who had access to the stuff gave her another jab. When Almore came back, he got scared and carried her down to breathe in monoxide.
How did you ever manage to live so long, Marlowe?
By not getting too much afraid of professional hard guys. Almore is guilty, but as a practical matter, you know his nurse, Mildred Haviland, killed her. She was playing house with Almore. She wanted the money. She wanted to make it permanent. You know all this because you covered it up.
She came to me. She still needed me.
You covered it up, but you made sure to scare her out of town after it, out of reach, out of danger. You were getting away with it. Why did you come up to Puma Point looking for her?
How did I know where to look?
I think she still wanted money, wanted it badly. She must have been sick of Bill Chess. Did she write to Almore asking for money? Did he send you to scare her again?
That makes no difference now. She's dead. I loved her. I would do the same again.
Yeah. I'm just telling you all this so that you won't hang the murder of the lady in the lake or anything else on Kingsley that doesn't belong to him.
One murder does.
If it does, I'll help you hang it on him. Let's find Patton and get into the cabin.
Mr. Kingsley. Mr. Kingsley, I gotta talk to you a little. Kingsley.
What? Marlowe, who are these people?
This is Constable Patton.
Yes, I know.
And this is Lieutenant DeGarmo from Bay City. He has to talk to you.
Oh, God. I must have fallen asleep. I got drunk. I've been asleep.
Your wife is dead, Kingsley.
Dead?
Last night. I don't suppose that's news to you. Show him the yellow scarf, Marlowe. Careless of you to leave that behind you.
Leave it? Leave it where?
In the hotel room where your wife was strangled.
The lieutenant considers this scarf as evidence that you were hidden in the room, knocked me out, and then killed your wife.
We also know you've no alibi for last night.
I came up here.
By way of Bay City?
Marlowe was taking care of all that.
Is the scarf yours?
Yes, but I gave it to Marlowe. He was wearing it so that my wife would recognize him.
I don't get this. I don't get this at all. Is somebody kidding me, Marlowe?
All I ever said was that the scarf was in the room and that it belonged to Kingsley. You didn't seem to want to know anymore.
Jesus, what a sucker I've been. How much are you getting paid to cover up Kingsley's murders, Marlowe?
He's getting paid to prove my wife didn't murder Chris Lavery.
Too bad he can't.
I've already earned my money.
You care to prove all this, son? I've heard a lot of talk, but it don't sound like evidence.
Crystal Kingsley could not have shot Lavery because Crystal Kingsley had been dead for a month, drowned in Little Fawn Lake by Mildred Haviland. She was the woman I met last night, the woman DeGarmo found dead in the hotel.
But don't you think Bill Chess would know his own wife?
The body was in the water a month, had blonde hair, wore his wife's clothes and jewelry. She left a note and her car and clothes were gone.
Yeah, I should have thought of that myself. They were lookalikes.
We had no reason to be suspicious. As far as we knew, Mrs. Kingsley left her car in San Bernardino and went to El Paso. It could have been a year before we even found the body. Muriel could have run off, as the note said. You might have put both in the missing persons file unsolved, except for Lavery.
Why did she kill him?
He was on his way up to the lake to see Crystal, and he bumped into Mildred, wearing Crystal's clothes at the Prescott Hotel. She got him to stay with her, but he had to die.
Well, for God's sake, why did Crystal have to die?
Money. Mildred needed money. She had killed for it before, and the Bay City cop she had been married to was fool enough to cover up for her. She ended up here, but she needed money to get out, so she tried Almore again. But he sent DeGarmo up to look for her, and that scared her, because DeGarmo is the sort of fellow you can never quite be sure of.
The sands are running out against you, Marlowe.
I'll say what I have to say. When Crystal decided she was bored and gave Bill Chess a whirl, it gave Mildred her opportunity. She was a nurse. She could handle a body. She was a good swimmer, too.
Yeah, it could be done. So she hid the car.
It had to be someone who knew the country. Then she ran into her first snag, Lavery. I met her there after she killed him and didn't know. She was quite an actress.
Yeah, but who killed her last night?
She was killed by somebody who thought she needed killing. Somebody who loved her and hated her. Somebody who was a good enough cop to find her. A good enough cop to stand completely still behind a curtain. And too much of a cop to let her get away with murder. But stupid. Stupid enough to look for a fall guy. And stupid enough to look too fast. You've been a little crazy, DeGarmo.
I know you haven't got a gun, Marlowe. Patton has. But I don't think he'll have the swift to reach it. You're a fat old man, Patton. You'd be an easy target.
Not fat, just well covered.
This thing will blow a hole in the wall. You're just making guesses, Marlowe. What's your evidence?
Under your fingernails. She was stripped and raked with scratches. The way a man might do to a woman who made a small private hell for him and wouldn't let him alone.
I want to get out of here. Not very far, maybe. But by myself. Any objections?
Can't be done. You know I can't just let you walk out. It's my duty to take you.
How do you figure to do it?
I don't know, son. I don't want no holes in my belly. But this is my territory.
Let him leave. He can't get out of these mountains. That's why I brought him up here.
Look, I'll tell you what I'll do, Patton. I'll put the scumbag under my arm, and we'll start from scratch.
I'm sitting down, and I ain't as fast as you. All this ain't my trouble, and look at the jam I'm in.
I like you, Patton.
You gave me a break. You shouldn't ever give a man like me a break. I've been a shooter more years than you've been alive, son. The arm ain't too bad, is it now?
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all. I'll be going now.
Don't do that.
I'm gonna walk out that door. There's only one way to stop me. So long, fatty.
He'll take my car.
Well, he gave me a break. I guess I owe him one. There's only one way out of these mountains, and that's across the dam. There's three armed sentries on it. All we need to do is get to a telephone.
He may not go that far.
He won't kill himself. He wants that done for him.
Another of your simple observations about human nature?
You took a lot of risk with him.
A lady had confidence in me.
I don't suppose you'd ever let a lady down, son.
I don't suppose.
Tell you what's going to give me a lot of pleasure. Letting Bill Chess out of jail.
And winning the election on the strength of it.
Now, you know I'm too old to go to work, son.
The way the sergeant of the guard told it, DeGarmo ignored the first sentry. And when the one in the center of the dam tried to stop him, he drove straight at him till he had to jump for his life. By that time, they had signaled to the last sentry. They had their orders. The orders said in a case like this, they were to shoot. The last sentry shot. And DeGarmo saw nothing but red as the car swerved off the top of the dam and went plunging down into the deep, green lake. There was a war on, all over the world.